I rejoice heartily in the Lord. In my God is the joy of my soul. For he has clothed me with the robe of salvation and wrapped me in a mantle of justice. Like a bridegroom adorned with a diadem, like a bride bedecked with her jewels. As the earth brings forth its plants and the garden makes its growth spring up, so will the Lord God make justice and praise spring up before all the nations. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
testify to the light, so that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to testify to the light. And this is the testimony of John. When the Jews from Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to him to ask him, "Who are you?" he admitted and did not deny it, but admitted, "I am not the Christ." So they asked him, "What are you then? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you, so we can give an answer to those who sent us? What do you have to say for yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as Isaiah the prophet said." Some Pharisees were also sent. They asked him, "Why then do you baptize, if you are not the Christ, or Elijah, or the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but there is one among you whom you do not recognize, the one who is coming after me, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to untie." This happened in Bethany across the Jordan, where John was baptized. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
This is one of only two weekends where the priests and the deacons wear robes color because the theme has to be rejoicing. The Latin is Gaudete, Gaudete Sunday. It's interesting that St. Paul starts to tell the people in his little section of his letter today to rejoice always. Good question to ask ourselves. Are we rejoicing? Are we people who have joy? Well, St. Paul himself is an interesting character because he was tested mightily in this whole area. He tells us about his tribulations. He mentions that he was shipwrecked. He was beaten with rods a number of times. He faced angry mobs. He was run out of town. All in the course of his missionary work. And then he was imprisoned, we believe, about three different times. And eventually he ended up on what we might call the death row, or at least that was what he was contemplating. But even then, he said, "Whether I live or die, it doesn't really matter, because if I die, I'll be with the Lord. If I live, I can continue to work for him." So he was a man who did not let his happiness depend upon what was happening to him. As many people in our culture do today, they're happy if the sun is out, if their friends are with them, if they have what they want, if they are feeling appreciated, or any one of a number of things. And those are good things, of course. But a real saint, or a person who is steeped in joy, the person who can smile through his tears even, I can think of a picture of St. Therese, the little flower. She said the same thing. what kind of joy is this? The joy that people who are in love with the world do not know, because the world really has nothing. It's something like beautiful wrapping paper with nothing inside. There's so much about the secular preparations for the Christmas, or as people call it today, the holidays, that is simply empty. And it's almost a symbol, really, of our culture in many ways. Now think about this one. A young woman conceives a child. Her husband is about ready to divorce her. How could she be filled with joy in circumstances of this type? I'm actually describing the Blessed Virgin Mary. Her response is the solemn response for today: my soul rejoices in my God. Now, how could she say a thing like that, given her circumstances? Again, she was a woman who was steeped in love for God, a woman of faith. And it's not to say that she didn't have any difficulties. I mean, she wasn't a statue. Things troubled her. She was tempted and so forth. But she had a solid footing in the life of the Spirit. So her happiness was not dependent upon her external circumstances. Even in the midst of her difficulties, she did not in any way, shape, or form give in to despondency or despair. Now, we live in a society which has many substitutes for joy. I mean, these are false substitutes. We could say counterfeits. One of the counterfeits for joy is pleasure. Pleasure is not a bad thing. But when pleasure becomes an end in itself, it can indeed be very damaging. For example, a person can become quite ill from eating too much or drinking too much. And often when people do that, what they're looking for is filling a deep void. There's some emptiness in their life, but they're filling it with food and drink. And food and drink cannot fill a spiritual emptiness. It can't do that. It's not capable of doing that. So again, we're dealing with, what is it that fills us? Does God fill us, or do we let other things take His place? In our country today, we have a culture, a drug culture. It's a big problem. I don't mean to sound as if there's nothing that can be done about it, except to say that at the root of it, in many cases, is the people are really hungering for something that only God can give them, but they don't know that. They're looking for excitement and so forth. They don't know joy, many of them, not real joy. So they use pleasure as a substitute. And it just doesn't work. Pleasure has a part to play in life. I mean, if we didn't get any pleasure from eating, many people would stop eating. But it doesn't substitute for joy. You have to be careful. Looking only for things that gratify us. Gratification is not necessarily going to fulfill us or satisfy us. God can do that. He wants to do it. But we have to let Him do it. I remember many years ago there was a documentary on television. It was on educational television. It had to do with the life of a monastery. Now, mind you, the camera crew and the producers and so forth were not religious people. They were not interested in the faith. But they were intrigued by the concept of people living together as monks. So they went to the monastery. And they saw the monks working, recreating, praying. One thing they noted about the monks which surprised them, they noted that the monks were very happy. And there was a certain joy in that monastery that they had never really experienced themselves. Now the monks, to this day, I mean, they take vows of poverty. They don't want anything in their own names. Chastity, obedience to their superior. Three things that the world does not, or our culture does not in any way appreciate. But the ways of God are not the ways of men. And if anything, the people who filmed this documentary learned something. That, practicing the faith properly does bring people a certain amount of happiness. Now, it doesn't give us complete happiness, because that's heaven. But if we live our faith the way we're supposed to live it, and have lives of prayer, it does make a big difference. Now, one of the things that Karl Marx said, and obviously Karl Marx is a very problematic character, he wrote the Communist Manifesto, he accused all religion of being something like opium, which is a drug. But the thing that he didn't realize is that drugs will provide an escape for people from reality. Our religion does not do that. We are not escaping from anything. We are solidly planted in reality. We are solidly planted in the reality of this world that God made. But with our hearts set on the next world, we're not determined by what goes on in this world. And we're not escaping. We're living in reality. We're not despairing either. And this is the kind of thing that Karl Marx had no idea about. Because he was not a religious man at all. He thought, he mocked religion. He thought it was something that only a fool would entertain. The thing is, we believe in Jesus. We believe he's our Savior. We believe that he loves us. We believe that he's real. That he has plans for us. All of these things should give us joy. St. Paul said in Galatians chapter 5, which you can read at home, he said the fruit of the Holy Spirit is love. Number one. Number two is joy. Number three is peace. Number four is patience. Number five is kindness, gentleness, humility, mildness, chastity, and generosity. The point of the matter is that joy comes about as a result of a person living a spiritual life. So people who spend time in prayer regularly are people who are going to taste a certain amount of joy. Throughout the day, a person will have this great foundation of joy. And it's nothing that we can really get or seek on its own, but it comes about as a result of life with God. Mother Teresa used to say, and Mother worked with all of the people who were dying in the drugs, or not all of them, but many of them in India, never let anything get in the way of the joy that is supposed to be ours. Don't let the circumstances and situations of the world crush us. It's not worth it. The devil, of course, would love for people to fall away from the faith because of hardships and difficulties. We can't let him have his way. We need to live the way we're supposed to live. And if we do, we will have unbounded joy, not here, but in the life of the world to come. The happiest people who have ever lived are always the holy people, the saints. We're called to be saints. corporate prayer for his coming at Christmas, let us offer our prayers to the Father who gives bread to the hungry and sets prisoners free.
That the church may await the Lord's coming with hope and courage, we pray to the Lord. That those who have closed their minds to the good news may return to the community of the faithful, we pray to the Lord. That those who trust in the Lord may not lose heart, but be renewed in faith no matter what they suffer, we pray to the Lord. That in our community, strangers, widows, and orphans may be supported by our generosity and care, we pray to the Lord. And for those who are ill, especially Bob Elmore, Rich Zapp, Donald Smith, Bill Hoffman, Annette Rigno, Teresa Costello, Jane Wayman Waite, and Ken Truage, we pray to the Lord. And for those who have died, especially Ray Welsh, Albert Owak, and Dominic Torrio, and also for Patricia Coleman, for whom this Mass is being offered, we pray to the Lord.
Most loving Father, hear the petitions of your people, waiting in faith and hope for the coming of our Savior, whose splendor brings us everlasting joy. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Our hymn for the preparation of the gifts can be found in your banner book, number 340, People of the Night.
us of this gospel with the blessed apostles and all the saints who lead you throughout the ages. We may merit to be co-heirs of eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Say to the faint of heart, be strong and do not fear. Behold, our God will come and he will save us.
Our communion song can be found in your gather book, number 328. My soul in stillness waits.
Oh,
507 in your guide book, I want to walk as a child of the light.